Welcome, Emmanuel, to another online service. I'm so happy you could be here with us today online, and join me as we worship.
As we gather together for worship today, let us reflect on the majesty of our great and mighty God. Isaiah records for us this vision in chapter 6. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole world is full of his glory." Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, as we gather together today, we do gather to magnify and glorify your holy name. We thank you that you are a great God, a compassionate God, a loving God. And we pray that as we gather together, that you would receive and accept the praises of your people as we bring our worship today through prayer, through song, and through the spoken word. May you be exalted. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, thirsty. All who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy, as deep cries out to deep. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, thirsty. All who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of His mercy, as deep cries out to deep. We sing, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, come. We sing, Holy Spirit, as deep cries out too deep. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Hey, Emmanuel, this is the time in our service where we pray for our children. Join me and Toffee as we pray for you guys. Let's close our eyes and bow our heads. God, thank you so much that we are able to spend the holidays with our immediate families. God, we just pray that 2021 would be a great year. We pray for our church families and kids. We pray that they enjoy the rest of their Christmas break and that they would have some fun. But God, we also pray that they would have fun at school too, Lord, when school starts up again. God, we just pray that 2021 would be a great year. We pray for health and protection, and that you be with the family and children of Emmanuel. In your name we pray, amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Romans 6, 15 to 23. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? By no means. Don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one you obey? Whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. But thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. I am using an example from everyday life because of your human limitations. Just as you used to offer yourselves as slaves to impurity and to ever-increasing wickedness, so now offer yourselves as slaves to righteousness leading to holiness. When you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Happy New Year, everyone, and welcome to 2021. When we rang in 2020, there was a lot of excitement. Not only was it a new decade, but it was also the year of vision, 2020 vision. So can you see anything more clearly now? For many of us, the first thought might be a resounding no. It's been a year we want to forget, to put behind us, pretend that it never happened. But you know, I think it's actually provided us with some clarity in a number of things. Let me just give you a few examples. For instance, it has exposed anti-black racism and made it an essential challenge for American societies to address, all societies. Also, it has made us retreat into our homes and apartments and forced us to take inventory of what's important, like food and shelter, access to medical care, and it's really exposed a lot of things that are of secondary importance. And in addition to this, it's reminded us of the value and importance of our faith community, not just because we've been reminded of God's faithfulness through all of this, which of course is true, but when we return to worship services again, we will never take for granted our face-to-face interaction ever again. Now, I could go on, but I'll end with this fourth point. It has impressed on us that there is a difference between living and simply existing. If you get out of this pandemic alive, what will you do with your life? That's the big question. You know, years ago, Mark Twain once said, "The church is a place where a nice, respectable person stands in front of other nice, respectable people and urges them to be nicer and more respectable." How do you feel about that statement? You know, Mark Twain was a brilliant man who wrote some incredibly insightful things with wit and humor, but what do you think? Do you think that's true? That this is a place where nice, respectable people gather to be more nice and more respectable? Are you a nice, respectable person? Am I? Well, I'd like to take a few moments to start today just looking at that word nice. Nice, as an adjective describing people, according to Oxford, means pleasant, agreeable, satisfactory, kind, good-natured. You know, this is, I think, one of the key words that many Canadians use to self-identify. Compared to other countries, most Canadians are very nice people. Or, similar to other English-speaking countries, we're very similar, except we are nicer. Have you heard people say things like that? Sometimes I think we take pride in that. It's one of the things that gives us a sense of national identity and pride that we treat each other well, that we're nice to each other. You know, as I was thinking about the word nice, somebody came to mind, Jan's uncle. His name was Art White. He had a garage in a small town in Ontario. And he was a great mechanic, and he treated people fairly, and everybody in town knew Art White and trusted him to keep their car running in good order. He was honest and trustworthy, kind and compassionate, you know, salt of the earth, respected and appreciated in the community. Art was a really nice guy. But you know, we can just as easily use that word with people we hardly know. One of the things I've observed is that we will often use the adjective nice when we're describing somebody that we don't even know very well. Perhaps it's an acquaintance. You know, something like, "Oh, Jessica? Oh yeah, I've met her a few times. Yeah, she's really nice. She's got a nice house, a good job, nice, reliable car, nice family. Her husband's really nice, too. What does that even mean? It probably means nothing more than Jessica makes a good first impression. My suspicion is that we use the word nice because we can't think of a better adjective, so we stick to an easy one that really doesn't say much of anything. And it makes me less and less comfortable with Mark Twain's tongue-in-cheek evaluation of the church as nice, respectable people. You know, we've just come through the Christmas season, and we all know that Santa Claus makes his list with just two categories. You're either naughty or you're nice. Our kids grow up measuring themselves against this cultural baseline. Have I been nice enough to justify a gift for Christmas? But should we be content with nice? Is it enough to come to the realization someday that, hey, I'm a nice guy, and thereafter be content that we've achieved all that's necessary in life? You know, the more I think about it, the less I like it. Nice is mediocre. It's average, maybe slightly above average, but it's very middle of the road. You know, it's like the school report card that says, satisfactory, demonstrates some of the necessary knowledge and skills approaching the provincial standards. Now, maybe that's okay if it's a subject in school that you didn't like, or you forgot to study for the exam, or it was just a required course that you didn't care about. But what if that describes your life? I don't know about you, but I wouldn't want to be that person, that nice guy, approaching our cultural moral standards. A few years ago, I reread Tolkien's The Hobbit. You know, he had a masterful command of the English language, and his books have great depth in the way he develops the characters. For example, at the beginning of The Hobbit, his depiction of the dwarves gives you the impression that they are strong and brave, while Bilbo, the hobbit, comes across as indecisive and cowardly. But as the book continues, it becomes clear that Bilbo is by far more adventurous and resourceful than he ever imagined. And then Tolkien describes the dwarves this way, quote, "There it is. Dwarves are not heroes, but calculating folk with a great idea of the value of money. They are tricky and treacherous and pretty bad lots. Some are not, but are decent enough people like Thorin and company, if you don't expect too much." Ouch. They're decent enough people if you don't expect too much. That sounds dangerously close to nice. And I don't like it. So let me tell you one thing that really bugs me, that grates on my nerves like fingernails on a chalkboard. Something that makes my skin crawl. When people say Jesus was nice. It certainly was true that Jesus was kind and humble and gentle, but nice? That adjective does not describe the Jesus I know. He was a man of authority. Even the religious experts of his day were afraid to engage him in theological debate because they were outwitted and frequently embarrassed whenever they tried. Jesus was a man of power. He calmed the wind and the waves. He ordered the demonic powers to obey him, and they did. Jesus was a man of absolute, uncompromising conviction and determination. He rejected shortcuts to power. He spoke out as a prophet against wickedness and injustice. He confronted the duplicity of the religious leaders, and he burned with righteous anger when the poor were taken advantage of and religion became a stumbling block to true faith. We can use many adjectives to describe Jesus. Humble, yes. Kind, yes. Compassionate, sure. Nice, absolutely not. So, I'm not saying that we shouldn't ever use the word nice to describe someone, or that it's a bad thing to be considered a nice person. I'm just saying there's more. It's okay to be agreeable, satisfactory, as a starting point, but if that's all there is to your life, then I would suggest you need to set your sights a little higher. And what better time to do that than the beginning of a new year? January 1st, everybody thinks about change, about improvements, about upgrades. This may be a good place to start. I don't know if you've seen them, but around the city of Toronto, there are a number of bus shelter posters by the city encouraging people to take positive action to stop the spread of COVID-19. And they all feature people with a clever t-shirt design to catch your attention. And one of them has a software progress bar and a message saying, "Deleting 2020, it has a virus." I think that's clever. The message is about putting the past behind us and living differently in 2021 in order to prevent the coronavirus from continuing its devastating spread while the vaccination program gets going. And while I'm among the first people to agree with public health officials that we all need to pull together to stop the spread of COVID, I would ask a deeper question. Are you preserving your life? For what? Just to breathe and exist? Or is there something more important about life that we should be pursuing? Yes, there is one thing, this pursuit of godliness. We need to grow in faith to become the people that God wants us to be. Listen to what Paul describes in Romans chapter 8. "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters." That's what God is calling us to. Not just to live, to exist, but to be conformed to the image of his Son, Jesus. Now, let's do a quick little Bible word study. Let me ask you, what does the Bible say about the word nice? You know, to be honest, it doesn't say anything. The word nice does not even appear in the Bible. Never, not even once. Does that surprise you? I suppose you might respond, well, maybe not nice, but the Bible uses the word good. Aren't they basically the same? And the short answer is, in English, yes, nice and good might be synonymous, but not in the Bible. I pulled my biggest, thickest theology book off the library shelf this week to look up the definition of the word good. Agathos is generally used for what is good and useful, especially moral goodness in relationship to God, who is perfect. The God of the Bible doesn't want you to be nice. He wants you to be perfect. That's what goodness means in Scripture. It's about moral goodness. It's not measured against some statistically adjusted average based on a typical person or any other arbitrary standard. It's the goodness in relation to the absolute moral perfection of a holy God. We have human institutions such as courts that differentiate the relative goodness of people. The innocent are released and the guilty are punished. At least that's how it's supposed to work. But these earthly standards of goodness crumble in the presence of God's greatness and moral perfection. As one biblical commentator has written, "The natural man is irretrievably in bondage to the powers of sin and death, and has no right to claim the attribute good for himself." This is precisely what Paul is arguing in Romans chapter 6. In verse 16, don't you know that when you offer yourselves to someone as obedient slaves, you are slaves of the one you obey, whether you are slaves to sin, which leads to death, or to obedience, which leads to righteousness. So you can choose to be a servant of God, and that choice will lead you to increasing righteousness. Any other path, any other journey or philosophy is ultimately the same as choosing to remain in sin, and it leads inexorably to death. Human beings, according to Scripture, are not intrinsically good, who make the occasional mistake here and there. Rather, we are intrinsically corrupted by sin and slaves to disobedience until we enter a relationship with God through faith in Jesus Christ. I may be a little better than my neighbor, and someone down the street may be a little bit better than both of us, but all of our goodness amounts to nothing in the presence of God. Or to express it more positively, we are good not because we are intrinsically virtuous or worthy, but insofar as we receive a share of God's goodness, we can also then pass his goodness on to others by doing good. The title of this sermon is No More Mr. Nice Guy. And you know, that's a common expression in the English language used to denote the moment in time when a nice person is being pushed around and they decide to push back. You know, it's a common theme in action movies when the good guy feels there's no alternative and he has to fight back in order to defeat the bad guys. You think of James Bond versus the supervillain. But the Bible paints a much different picture for us. It challenges us to take a long, hard look at ourselves and realize that nice is inadequate. It forces us to redefine our categories. Instead of nice, the Bible challenges us to be righteous. Someone whose life is patterned after the righteousness and moral perfection of God. Or as Paul says, conformed to the image of his Son. So don't be nice, be righteous. You know, in Romans chapter 6, the Apostle Paul goes on in verse 17 to say, but thanks be to God that though you used to be slaves to sin, you have come to obey from your heart the pattern of teaching that has now claimed your allegiance. You have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. You see, in the final analysis, there are really only two choices. We can either choose to love and serve God, or we are slaves to sin. There's no loophole here. If you don't choose to serve God, then you are effectively choosing to serve sin, whether you know it or not. There is no middle category. Dr. Cranfield, a well-known biblical scholar, put it this way. He says, quote, the question of man's being free in the sense of having no master at all simply does not arise. The only alternatives open to him are to have sin or to have God as his master. The man who imagines he is free because he acknowledges no God but his own ego is deluded. For the service of one's own ego is the very essence of the slavery of sin. The one alternative ends in death. The other ends in service to God. So you must choose. And the one clear choice, the only one that leads to life, is to choose service to God. And Jesus said this, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these other things will be given to you as well. And the other things that Jesus is speaking about here are food and clothing and the basic necessities of life. Our first priority, our high calling, our ultimate raison d'être is to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. You know, earlier in the message, I mentioned Jan's uncle, Art White. And if I only told you that he was a great mechanic and a nice guy, you would be missing so much more about this man. Because he was also a man of faith, dedicated to Jesus, and he sought to live his life in a way that showed God's love to others. In addition to the garage, Art had a tow truck, and he lived in central Ontario in the middle of the snow belt. And in the winter months, he was often called out to rescue stranded motorists who had gone off the road in a snowstorm. After pulling the car out of the snowbank, if he found that it couldn't be driven safely without repairs, Art would invite the driver and whatever passengers were with him to come and stay at his house for the night. They would sort it all out in the morning. In fact, Art and Doris kept a spare room in their house, ready for anyone who was stranded, so they could stay the night. They never turned anyone away, and they treated total strangers just like family. Art was nice, but he was so much more than that. He was good. He knew how to live. And every time he served a stranger, he was really serving the Lord Jesus. Every time he did a repair for somebody free of charge because he knew they were going through tough times, he was really serving his Lord and Savior. Art knew how to live. And when he went to be home with his Lord a few years ago, he had been traveling the journey of righteousness for a good many years. That's the kind of life I want to live. No more Mr. Nice Guy. I want to be a righteous servant of God, to be good with the kind of good that is tied to the patient and persistent journey of someone who's consistently seeking first God's kingdom and his righteousness. Whether you've just begun this journey or whether you've been pursuing righteousness for a very long time, let's all be reminded of its primacy of place in our lives. Let's make this our passionate pursuit. Let us pray. Dear gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we thank you today for this message of faith from Romans, this encouragement to turn away from our past and turn towards you in faith, as obedient servants, as sons and daughters, made to reflect the image of Jesus, our Savior. Help us, we pray, to continue along the path of righteousness and goodness for your name's sake. Help us to give our lives in service, and in humble faith, may we seek your face each day. May we seek your will and your purpose in our lives. And as we find these things, Lord, will you use us in your service for the sake of your kingdom, so that others might also come to know and love you and serve you as Savior and Lord. We pray all of these things today in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And now, as we reflect on this challenging message from Romans, I want to leave you with a song today. But it's not my song to share. This one is a recording that Collie Smith made recently. It's an arrangement of Lauren Daigle's song, You Say. I'm sure if you've heard the song before, you'll recognize it. It's a powerful song of faith. And I hope that you enjoy this new arrangement of it. And thanks to Collie and for Dave Longnecker for producing this wonderful, encouraging piece of music. You Say.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lies they tell me I will never measure up. Am I more than just a sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know.
Morning, Emmanuel. Join with me as we pray. God, you have been with us. You've helped us and guided us through days of stress, pain, and anger, and even feelings of hopelessness this past year. Thank you for your steadfast love in a world of uncertainty. We know that many have lost many things this past year. Lost jobs, lost opportunities, and lost loved ones. Please comfort and bring peace to them. Mend our hearts and bring us to a place of healing. God, we also pray for Canada. We pray for those who've experienced and have been impacted by residential schools. It's heartbreaking and we mourn with them. We also pray for those who've experienced pain and hate and racism this past year. We pray that people would love you and love one another as you told us in scripture. God, help us to speak up and act against systematic injustice and bring real, lasting change through living out the gospel. We know with you all things are possible. God, we also pray for our children and youth as they finish up school for the summer. Be with them and help them as they study. We pray that they would finish well this year. We pray for their mental health. We pray that they would know how much they are loved by you and cherished as well by their families. God, we pray for their parents as they continue to juggle so many different things. Please be with them. Give them times of rest throughout their day, times for fun and joy. May our families at Emmanuel feel and experience your love and provision. God, we also pray for our summer ministries, which will be happening soon. We pray that you will bring the right team together and that the summer camps would impact our church community and neighborhood in positive ways. God, we also pray for our church family. May we stay encouraged and feel connected with one another. We pray that we would be a light and reveal God's kingdom in our communities. May we work together to build your kingdom through our ministries, families, homes, and lives. We also thank you for your faithfulness and love this past year. Thank you for everything that you've done for us. We pray all of these things in your name. Amen.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found. I am yours. I am loved. I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true, 'cause I am found. I am yours, I am loved. I'm made pure, I have life. I can breathe, I am healed, I am free. 'Cause you are strong, you are sure, you are life, you endure, you are good, always true, you are light, breaking through. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my
I am found, I am yours, I am loved, I'm made pure, I have life, I can breathe, I am healed, I am free, 'cause you are strong, you are sure, you are life, you endure, you are good, always true, you are light, breaking through, you are more than enough, you are here, you are love, you are hope, you are grace, you're all I have, you're everything. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Here's my life, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true. Speak what is true.
And now it is time for us to gather around the Lord's table. I invite you to this table in the name of the one who said, I am the bread of life. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is here that we remember how he gave his body and his blood to save us. For we read in Scripture, on the night he was handed over, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray together. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving us even unto death. Send your Spirit upon us so that we may know that all who eat and drink at your table, in our congregation, and around the world are one body and one holy people. The bread of life, Jesus' body, given for you, take this and eat it in remembrance of him. After supper, Jesus took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, remember me. Let us again give thanks. Let us pray. Lord, give us clean hearts, forgiving hearts, praising hearts. And as we drink this, we join with our brothers and sisters in heaven and on earth, giving thanks to you in the endless song of praise. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ, shed for you, take this in remembrance of him. And so we have come to the Lord's table. We have eaten the bread of heaven. The Holy Spirit will transform us from within so that we can see with Jesus' eyes, hear with Jesus' ears, speak with Jesus' mouth. Feel the world as Jesus feels, to taste and see that the Lord is good. Go into your week nourished by the bread of life. Amen. As we prepare to present our offerings to God, let us hear this encouraging word from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, starting at verse 7. But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Let us pray. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you today that we can trust you to provide for our daily needs. This has been a difficult year that we've come through, and many of us have experienced some hardships, but we know that you have remained faithful to us, that we can continue to trust you to provide for us. And so as we come today to the service of worship, we come with thankful hearts, and we want to offer to you this portion as an offering of thanksgiving and praise to you from our gratitude for your provision for us. Receive it, we pray, and use it for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Today we have a special presentation as we welcome three new members into our fellowship at Emmanuel Baptist Church. I'm going to ask Liz Lindsay, our church moderator, to come and to make this presentation.
Good morning. This is a time in the service when I have the privilege of virtually presenting three candidates who have requested to become a member of Emmanuel Baptist Church. Due to the current situation, this will be slightly different than how it was done previously. First, let me take the opportunity to speak about the three different ways of becoming a member of the church. First is by baptism. We here at Emmanuel practice believer's baptism. It is the first significant act through which the believer proclaims personal faith in Christ. For those baptized, another way is by letter of transfer. The person has been baptized, and a letter of transfer from the previous church is sufficient. Thirdly, is by Christian experience. The person has professed their faith in Christ as Lord and Savior and experienced baptism, but no church letter is available. And in these situations, these individuals can become a member on the basis of Christian experience. Sometimes it's just not possible to get a letter of transfer. Today, our three candidates are Tracia Nelson, Pastor Saeed, and his wife Marion. Many of you already know Tracia. Tracia has been attending Emmanuel with her mother, Kathy Nelson, for some time now. Tracia is quiet until you start a conversation with her about the Lord. Also, many of you may remember Pastor Saeed and his wife Marion. He delivered a sermon at Emmanuel sometime prior to our closure. At that time, both Pastor Saeed and Marion shared their testimony then. In the preceding months, we were informed of their desire to become members of Emmanuel. However, due to the closure, we were unable to include a notice of application and a processing of membership in a church bulletin. So in keeping with our rules of order, we provided that information in a letter that was sent out to you in December. Tracia was interviewed by Lynn Smith and myself. During the interview, Tracia shared that she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. And following the interview with Tracia, we reported to council, and the recommendation was accepted on the basis of transfer of membership from the People's Church here on Shepherd Avenue in Toronto. Pastor Saeed and Marion were interviewed by Carmen James Henry and Roger Smith. And the same process was followed, and recommendation was accepted by the church council on the basis of Christian experience. Due to our current situation, Tracia, Marion, and Pastor Saeed are not able to share with you their personal faith journey, Again, due to the closure and to ensure that we follow the rules of order, this process was communicated to you in the same letter in December. A notice of membership application was included in the weekly December e-letters that went out, along with an invitation for anyone to contact the church office to receive a copy of the candidates' bios. Anyone who had any concerns regarding their suitability for membership was asked to contact the church office. No questions or concerns have been raised. Tracia, Marion, and Pastor Saeed, today we're not able to confirm them in church, but your application for membership can be accepted by acclamation. So on behalf of the members of the Emmanuel Baptist Church, I'd like to welcome you as a member of the Emmanuel Baptist Church family. We rejoice at the prospect of you joining with us and worshiping and serving. We're unable to warmly welcome you, so I invite anyone who would like to extend a warm welcome to our new members to contact the church, either by email or telephone. Sadie will ensure that they receive that information. To our new members, Pastor Jonathan also has your certificate of membership. So Tracia, Marion, and Pastor Saeed, would you kindly contact the church to arrange the best way for you to receive them? Anyone who is questioning or thinking of becoming a member, I invite you to reach out to Pastor Jonathan, either with a call or an email, to receive any kind of answers that you may need or information so you have clarification. I turn this over to now Pastor Jonathan, who will pray for our new members. And I just think this is a wonderful way for us to start 2021. God bless you.
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you today for this wonderful day where we welcome these three new members, for Pastor Saeed and for Marion and for Tracia. We are so grateful for their faith and for their desire to serve you and for their willingness to become members of this church in order to be a part of this community, to be fully committed and engaged in the life and ministry of Emmanuel Baptist Church, and to be a part of all of the things that we are doing to reach out to our community and also to continue to grow and develop in our faith and deepening our roots in the Word of God and in our expressions of faith and worship here at Emmanuel. Lord, I pray that you would bless each one of them, that you would encourage them and strengthen them. We thank you for Tracia and for the way that she has been so naturally a part of the life of the church here, that you will encourage her to find her place of service, that that she would be able to give of her time and her talents in the service of the King. Lord, we pray also for Pastor Saeed and for Marion and for their work with the Farsi language congregation that is meeting at our church building. We thank you for their faithfulness through this difficult time and for the exciting things that you're doing in their congregation. And we just pray that you would strengthen and encourage them, that they would have the strength and the endurance that they need to be able to meet the requirements of their ministries. And so, Lord, we thank you for these three wonderful people. We pray your blessing upon them, that you would strengthen and encourage them and bless them today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
And now be dismissed with God's benediction from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus.
Amen.